You're ready now.
All right, so I show the time at 4:03, and we'll call ourselves to order. Roll call, please.
Eva Henry.
Here.
Bill Holen. Nancy Sharp. Elise Jones. Deb Gardner. David Beacom.
Here.
Tim Mock. Chrissy Paganello. Anthony Graves. Robin Kneach. Kevin Flynn. Roger Partridge. Dave Weaver. Gail Watson. Don Rozier. Libby Szabo. Bob Pfeiffer.
Here.
Bob Roth.
Here.
Larry Vittem. David Spellman. Aaron Brockett. Matt Applebaum. Ann Justin. Lynn Baca. Rex Bell. George Teal.
Yes.
Doris Trular. Carrie Penaloza. Ron Engels. Catherine Heider. Laura Christman. Alex Brown. Richard Champion. Gail Christie. Rick Teeter. Here. Debbie Nasta. Carl Randolph. Steve Conklin.
Here.
Joe Jefferson. Steve Yates. Jeff Deacon. Mark Gruber. Daniel Dick. Lisa Jones. Laura Brown. Lynette Kelsey. Henry Ergot. Scott Norquist. Sersha Karis Graves. Casey Brown. Ron Rakowski.
Present.
Mike Hillman. Brad Weasley. Stephanie Walton. Shakti. Dana Gutwein.
Here.
Jerry Bean. Phil Cernanek.
Present.
Jackie Millay. John Peck, Gabe Santos, Ashley Stolzman, Bob Muckle, Connie Sullivan, Dan Greenberg, Colleen Whitlow, Richard Kramer, Deborah Jerome, Sean Foray, Chris Larson, Kyle Mullica, Jordan Sowers, John Dyack,
here.
Sally Daigle, Gary Howard, Rita Dozal, Adam Matkowski, Eric Montoya, Herb Atchison,
here.
Joyce J, Gary Sanford, Deborah Perkins Smith, Bill Van Meter.
Okay. All right. So attachment A is the summary of the June 1st, 2016 board work session. Any comments or corrections to be made to that? Seeing none, we'll go on to public comment, agenda item 4. The chair requests that there be no public comment on issues for which a prior public hearing has been held before the board. Please note the public will have an opportunity to speak on specific items in the Metro Vision Plan between the staff presentation and committee discussion. Anybody here that would like to address the board this evening? Seeing nobody, we'll move on to agenda item 5, which is attachment B. So there were, in the June discussion, there were several questions that the board asked the staff to provide additional information on. And on under agenda item 5 on the second page, those questions are highlighted with some staff feedback. And we have Brad Calvert here to do a presentation on this item.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Good afternoon, everyone. I hope you recovered from your long holiday weekend. So I do have a quick presentation on this agenda item that's also in your packet, but I'll pull it up here real quick. As noted in the memo, last month, you spent a fair amount of time talking about overall plan performance measures and the Metro Vision plan. During that time, you endorsed 12 measures. There were 8 that were previously discussed at NVIC that had been held for a while. There was one slight staff substitution, but you went ahead and endorsed those 8. And then there were 6 additional measures that were presented for the first time last month. You were able to sort of spend a fair amount of time on 5 of those, and you recommended 4 out of the 5. But the 6th one, you didn't quite get all the way through your discussion, so that's really kind of what we're here to do today, to kind of hopefully get to a decision or a recommendation or an endorsement one way or the other as to whether this measure makes sense or whether it's a measure like this should be included in the document overall. So a little bit about we really wanted to do a presentation to kind of give you some visual because this felt like a very visual item in a lot of ways. In thinking about how we come up with an overall plan performance measure that thinks about risk associated with hazards is difficult because those things are simply are difficult to predict, right? So they vary greatly year over year. Region areas of the region that are impacted, the type of hazard that occurs, those sorts of things. So in thinking about how to find a little bit of common ground with the other types of measures that you've previously seen, we were looking for something that was maybe a little bit more predictable that we can monitor over time and understand trends and also set targets. So for that reason, the proposal that you saw last month and that's coming back to you again this month is really focusing on two types of disasters, fires and floods that in our region obviously have a great deal of impact on people and lives for those areas that are impacted. So really what we're suggesting as staff is to track over time share, percentage, whatever term you prefer, of homes and employment located in these high-risk areas. So for instance, the map that you have up on the screen that's included in the presentation for wildfire high-risk threat areas, we're using those areas that are defined by the Colorado State Forest Service. So in this map, we're really interested in areas identified as high or very high risk, so numbers 4 and 5. So you can see areas that have a lot of orange and that darkest red, largely in the sort of the southwest portion of the region, and then some of the northern portions as well. On the flooding side, we're looking at areas that would be covered by what's typically known as sort of the 100-year floodplain. So areas, homes and businesses that are already located in these areas or would be located in these areas in the future, even as these areas actually change. I mean, FEMA maps these areas. They change from time to time. So that's also something that this measure would take into account. So a little bit sort of quick summary of these two things that really just sort of talks about kind of the methodology that comes into them. As I mentioned, the wildfire threat is really something that comes from the Colorado State Forest Service and FEMA on the sort of floodplain side of things. So we're going to walk you through a very basic visualization that may or may not be needed for everybody, but it helped us sort of visualize kind of what this measure is trying to accomplish. So we'll take this basic visualization as kind of the status quo for today. We've got a lot of houses in the region. Some of them are already located in high-risk flood areas. Some of them are already located in high-risk fire areas. So this measure is really trying to understand how this region changes over time. So fast forward 25 years, we've added, in this case, 6 new houses, some of which are green and some of which are red. And in this case, we've had 1 new home located in a high-risk fire area, but the remaining homes have been located in areas that are not known to be of a potentially high risk. So in this case, we're moving towards that target, decreasing that share over time. So back to the base case, again, kind of where we are today, 3 out of the 10 homes are in these high-risk areas. Going forward, we've added substantial growth to the region in the form of housing units, but in this case, we've actually had more housing units locate as a percentage in this high-risk, in this case, fire area than in other areas, and again, not necessarily predisposed to these risks. So we're going in the opposite direction. We now have more homes at risk as a percentage in our region. So that's really kind of why we're talking mostly about share here or percent. The memo talks a little bit about kind of some data issues that are really sort of back up kind of why we went in this direction of share versus, I know last month there was a little bit of talk about sort of total number of housing units or total number of jobs is maybe being the right way to go. And our general feeling as to why we still think share is, if you do want a measure along this line, in the grand scheme of things, we're talking about a relatively small spatial area in the region. They just have these events obviously have huge impacts, so they are critical for the region. So small land area, small number of homes and jobs that potentially could be impacted. And the other thing that's kind of noted in the memo, if you are sort of on the wonky side of things on a data perspective, these are also areas that from our data sets that we use to build this sort of master inventory of homes and jobs, they tend to be the weakest in areas farther from the more densely populated parts of the region. So over time, we're simply going to get better and better at that data. And so we are concerned that just simply focusing on number of homes and number of jobs, when we see change over time, some of that may be just data noise and the data getting better. And if we think of it as a share, we kind of can smooth that a little bit because we'll be seeing data improvements across the region. So that's just sort of it for background, and that concludes staff's presentation.
Thank you. So this was the one item that, as Brad mentioned, we did not complete last time. And so I guess the first portion of this is whether or not this is something that we want to recommend moving forward as part of the plan, or if there's not an appetite to do that at all. So I'll open the floor for discussion.
Actually,
Director Cernanek.
Brad, a couple of questions. Just as you go through this, is it residential units that you're using and business units? So that if there's like an office building that has 30 businesses in it, extreme maybe, but that would be 30, or is it that's one office building?
So it's housing units, the number of like houses, and then it's jobs. So it's taking that establishment and the number of jobs that are within that establishment, so, which are pretty standard ways that we think of
so
counting
you,
things.
When you say houses, suppose one of the reds is a apartment building. Is that one unit?
No, it would if there are four, there'd be four.
Director Applebaum.
Yeah, just a question. So Boulder has way too much experience with floodplains and areas of hazard with fire. But on the floodplain issue, and maybe there's no good way to do this, to fix this, the 100-year floodplain is not necessarily high risk per se. There's a lot that goes into that category. Heck of a lot of boulders in the 100-year floodplain. Much of it is very low risk, kind of shallow flooding. Anything new that's being built has to be built to modern standards, which in our case are even stricter than FEMA standards. So I'm not trying to say Boulder doesn't have problems. We got big problems with flooding, but I'm not sure you're quite getting at what you want to measure. That's my bigger problem. If what you're really trying to measure is high risk, I'm not, even though this is something we know how to count, I'm not sure it measures it correctly. It's just something we conveniently know how to count. Fire is even harder, but a worse problem in many ways. But flooding, I just kind of think of our city, and if you're really going to count everything that's in the 100-year floodplain and somehow consider that high risk, and if we build any more in the 100-year floodplain, even the modern standards, we're making things worse. I don't think we're making things worse. So that's where I kind of get stuck. Maybe in the whole metro area it works better. I don't know enough of how it looks elsewhere. Again, new construction, if built correctly, is not so much of a risk. Mm-hmm. So I don't know. I don't know if we got the right metric, I guess, is what I'm saying.
All good points. I mean, to your point, this one is kind of a tough nut to crack. You're relying on data sources that you don't have a lot of control over, which is not unusual. But to your point, sort of this idea of risk and spatially assigning risk to places in a 5,000 square mile area is not the easiest thing to do.
Well, I mean, at least for flooding, FEMA does have different flood zone categories, and maybe we should, because I signed me up for don't keep building things in the highest risk areas, because that's obviously self-defeating in the long run, whether it's fire or flood. But maybe we should look at some of the FEMA categories and deal with it that way and get a slightly better, maybe not, but maybe yes. Unfortunately for fire, I don't know that such a thing exists unless there's some insurance data you can look at.
And I think some of the points that you make are some of the very reasons that there were people not wanting to move this forward at all. So, Director Rakowski.
If I could pick up on the fire, two thoughts. One on the area, if you want to look for a rating, you could look at the fire departments or fire districts that cover that area and what their ISO ratings are. That would be, and that's sort of a standard that is national. And then the other thing is within departments, you know, some that are better funded and have more personnel and equipment and training than other areas, and so that might be, but that's all quantifiable, and so that might be a way to further quantify the wildfire risk.
Director Millay.
I think Director Applebaum raised an issue that I think is relevant with a lot of the performance measures that we're looking at. Just because we can measure something doesn't mean it's giving us the information that we are, that we actually care about. And I think it speaks to the idea that these performance measures, the way we're measuring them probably needs to be somewhat flexible in this document. And as we get more data sources and more refined data, where is the opportunity, and maybe staff could speak to that, where is the opportunity to do better when we learn more and have access to more information, and how is that built into the MetroVision document?
Sure. So the way that we're thinking about this is you have spent a fair amount of time talking about, let's call them 12 to 15 overall big picture planned performance measures. But we don't anticipate that that tells the entire story. There is much more story to be told. When you think of us, of our role in collecting, disseminating, and interpreting data, that's a big part of what we do at DRCOG. So we will not just be focused on the 12 to 15 measures that really are the coarsest regional performance measures. We will be constantly collecting data and information, and this document tells us what's important to the board, and we will always be looking for new data sources and different ways to tell that story, to round it out some, right? We just wanted to get to kind of a central starting point for what that performance measurement might look like, but recognize that over time, you know, something else is going to come to light, a new way to measure it, a new way of thinking about data, and we will, you know, do our best to constantly be informing the board about how we're doing. And some of that's going to be these planned performance measures, and some of it's going to be other data that just, you know, comes and goes as new data becomes available. Is that helpful,
Director Millay?
I think it's very helpful when I sit in this room, but I think about the board members that are going to be sitting here 3 years from now, and how are we making sure that the person that picks this up and just looks at the performance target page that summarizes everything is going to understand all of that background that is, I think, so very important to the plan. So where is that being communicated to the public and to future board members?
I'm sorry, Mr. Calvert.
Sure. So our hope is that we can communicate that in a lot of ways, and frankly, most of it will not even be in the MetroVision document. It will be a continuous conversation. So, for instance, we every year do a safety report that talks about safety issues with our transportation network. That's something that's clearly important in MetroVision, and we have a single overall plan performance measure related to safety, but we will be reporting out on any number of other data and variables as well. So just imagine that over and over and over again, we have a congestion management process that we do each and every year. So that would also be a place where not just these sort of key overall plan performance measures, but we would be talking about where we are as a region on any number of issues. So MetroVision is sort of the starting point for what it's really a more global conversation that will be continuous about, you know, what we see as key issues that the board ought to consider, how it lands on you, how you respond as a board, how you respond in your own local communities as well.
Director Atchison.
Brad, I want to go back to just one item. I'm not talking about the performance measures, but more information. When we look at floodplain designations, whether regardless of which entity is here, a lot of that comes out of one particular group here in the metro area, and that's urban drainage and flood control. So if we're communicating with them, they are actually identifying, along with the counties and municipalities, opportunities to reduce those floodplain designations to smaller and get potential developments out of it. I mean, we've done that along with Adams County and some of our partners at the metro station that we're opening up in a couple of weeks. We got 30, 35 homes, I think, Eva, that we were able to update that floodplain, but with the cost of the work that we did through that group in the county, we got those homes out of the floodplain, which then dropped the flood insurance and stuff. So as we're doing planning, I think that's a group that we definitely have got to stay in touch with, because they're the ones who ultimately determine what is or isn't the floodplain. So if we can just make sure we're communicating that. I'm not asking you to do anything other than let's just talk to them, because they're the one who set the parameters for that.
And in fact, they may actually have a better statistic.
Yeah. Well, and they're also a funding source for helping get that out of there too.
Other comments or questions? So you can see in the bottom of the page there, the bottom of the first page, the staff recommendation for this particular item, and I'm not sensing an overwhelming amount of support, or it seems like a lot more ambiguity on this issue. Director Cernanik.
Director Roth, Chair. I think, as Matt points out, and as Herb mentions, being cognizant of what our risks that are essentially natural risks, particularly in this instance, sometimes exacerbated by human behavior, but are natural risks, and consciously not building in those areas or doing something that will mitigate and sometimes change the flood control plain, being one, and might change, with doing something to the environment might impact the wildfire risk, is something that is laudable because it kind of helps what might be the contagion that can occur across the area. And so I think that's good. I'm not sure the measures are there, but I think, at least from my perspective, I'd like to see us have some focus there. I'm not sure what the measures are yet. And I would, I think the ISO ratings, there, and you have to understand the ISO ratings, because they also not only include the training of what kind of fire response there might be, but it also, what's the distance from the nearest station, what's the access to water or fire retardant. I mean, there's a number of factors that go into that, but certainly understanding that, and then understanding what urban drainage and the flood control district have as far as what do they look at, because they're very conscious of it and have been involved, at least in our city, if not others, in taking a look at that and taking a look at updating, which was a 50-year-old measure on what is the 100-year floodplain.
Director Applebaum.
Yeah, well, so since I gave this some grief, I do think we should keep this, but with the understanding, and maybe it should be clearer, that all of these metrics are will be improved over time as we learn more about them. And both in terms of better data collection and also just better understanding of what they mean and how to make them more meaningful. No, they're not perfect, but I think if you get rid of it, you lose to some extent the concept of, gee, it's really in the region's benefit to, as much as we can, reduce the number of houses and businesses in these high-risk areas. And you know, you need some way to measure that, imperfect though it may be. So I would keep this, but I think as Jackie said, we need to strive to measure things better as time goes along, and staff will do that. But somewhere in the plan, hopefully it will say that as well, so somebody reading it will understand that, well, we voted for less than, 1% in the high hazard zone, but now we're smarter and we know we have a different way of measuring that, and that should be okay to make that change. Just one other comment, and that's on the fire stuff, since, again, Boulder. These are places where you don't actually want to be the city that has the biggest issue, but we win on both of these, I think, sadly. So just on the fire crews, so we've got a full-time wildland fire crew. We just built them a station. We've got probably got the best stuff around. And you know what? If you ask our fire chief what they would do in a serious wildland fire coming at us from the west in one of our wonderful 80-mile-an-hour winds in the wintertime, the fire chief will tell you the following. Get the people out and watch, because there's absolutely nothing they can do about it. Create a fire line if they can somewhere in town. What actually helps us the most, which I don't think is quite captured, is another one of these subtleties, is our open space buffer, which for most of Western Boulder, the city, not all of it, provides a huge amount of grassland that keeps the wooded area away from the housed areas. And actually, when we had a fire a few years ago, it made a big difference. But again, those are subtleties. I don't expect you to capture all of that in one simple measure on day one. But at some point, maybe as we get more into this, we'll capture some of that. Anyway, I'd keep the metric, but with an understanding of what the metrics mean.
So I've got Director Teal, but I wanted to interject something real quick. On the item that we're going to discuss here in a few minutes, which is agenda item number 7, which is the preamble to this entire document, I just wanted to point out two items. One is that it talks about Metrovision being dynamic and flexible, reflects contemporary perspectives on the future of this region, and is updated as conditions and priorities change. Dr. Cog Board makes minor revisions to the plan annually and major updates as needed. And then the second part is the very last sentence in the preamble, which says local governments will determine how and when to apply the tenets of Metrovision based on local conditions and aspirations. So I think both of those pieces kind of play into some of the conversation here that we're having, that conditions do change, it does need to be updated, and in the preamble some of that that is covered as far as anticipating that this is a living document. Director Teal.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I like a lot of what Director Applebaum has pointed out, in that, you know, we do have we are a culture that has built our society in areas of natural hazard. There were areas of natural hazard that weren't that big a deal when the whole town could burn down and you'd slap it together the next year, which I believe has happened to almost every one of the municipalities around this table, with the exception of perhaps the most recent ones. But just about every one of us, my town has gone through that, Boulder's went through that, Denver's gone through that twice. And so the bottom line is, I think there is good reason here, but I'm just looking, the more I look at this, the more I see what we have the capability of measuring are the risks and effects of natural hazards that could be reduced. I'd be all in favor of pushing this forward to the board if we could edit out human-created hazards. They're human-created. Just because we see that we are not getting, we are not finding readily available things to measure, nor are we finding readily available items to define what that human-created hazard could possibly be. So, indeed, we do have risks and effects of natural hazards in our region. And I think it would be fine for us to move forward. And I actually kind of like the target and the baseline. I just, once again, and this kind of goes back to when this was an MVIC issue, I don't see the human created having a real place if we truly wish to measure and we truly wish to move forward.
Director Cernanek.
Yeah, just, I was going to add one additional thought as to a source. I know at least some of the fire departments do a structure survey and location and risk and a risk assessment along with that, and they might be another group to contact, because a survey of them to say whether their situation is better or worse might yield some data.
if not already thought of.
Director Shaw.
Thank you. I just had a question about perhaps tying this to some sort of dollar value of loss compared to the total value in this area. In other words, as Director Applebaum was stating, that with technology, sometimes you can build to protect against a risk, even if you're in a quote-unquote high-risk area, that measurement of loss, if there is a downward trend, not in dollar value, but in percentage of total dollars in that area, might give us some idea of how technology is helping us, even if we can't change the geography.
Mr. Colford?
Sure, I'll just add that that's something that we talked about. We were striving to give you some, sorry, Jerry, strive. We were aiming to give you something that was more predictable over time, right, rather than something that would be sort of dependent on the wildfire season or the flood season that happened over the course of a few years, right? So this was the one that felt like, okay, it's just giving us a sense of what's going on in the region in terms of susceptibility, though coarsely, to these risks. So.
Makes sense.
Director Sheriff Graves.
Couple of things. When you were reading the, so this is later in the agenda, but
correct.
I'll say it now because I might forget. right? I didn't hear in what you were reading any language about the change in our ability to measure, like different, and so I just thought that might be, maybe there would be an additional sentence that could be included that would include that comment from Director Millay as something that we would look to and possibly change.
Sure.
Okay. And then the other thing is just a question, and it may be out of ignorance, but a human-created hazard, Director Teal, what popped into my brain was, so if a wildfire is created by lightning, that's a natural hazard. If a wildfire is created by human error, that's a human hazard, human-created hazard. So I'm not sure I want to leave it out because there are incidences where hazards are created by humans, unfortunately. So that was just a comment.
So at this table, we don't vote. We take kind of a temperature of the crowd, more so to speak. Mr. Stiegel.
Just in observing and listening to the comments over the last two sessions, I want to just comment on a couple things coming out here. You're exactly right. There's no perfect measure. And strategy work to do it right is not set it and forget it. It is not that. It is an evolutionary process. It's dynamic to the point. So if there's no perfect measure, you have to settle for some things and start working them, as Director Applebaum said. You just kind of learn and you start perfecting them. That's how we would want to update that plan. I think high risk needs a definition around it. I think if you define high risks in a reasonable way from some source like FEMA or whatever, that's going to help you determine, you know, really to focus in on areas that you're most concerned about. The other is to think about measurement in two forms, lead and lag. Does that make sense to anyone yet?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. A lead measure, the percent of homes in high-risk areas. A lag measure, the costs associated with disasters in that area. Would there be a relationship between the number of homes in an area and the cost to rebuild them if something happened? Most likely. So if you think about lead indicators, that came out implicitly in the last meeting, and I think it really helps to think of them that way. And so that's why a single measure is not probably serving your needs. So there are other measures that, as Brad had indicated, that could be more indicators as opposed to waiting for the outcome, if you see. So you want some predictive nature in your strategy, and that's what those measures do.
All right. So, again, we don't vote here, but what I'm hearing is general consensus to move this forward, the only question is whether or not we are going to leave in the human-created hazards or not. Director Teal, any feeling different on that, or do you want to take a sense of the room on that issue?
Well, if we follow the idea that a cigarette being thrown outside of the out of the car and starting a forest fire is fits the measure of human caused, then shouldn't we be lumping motor vehicle fatalities as a measure here? Should we not be lumping structural fires due to electrical mismanagement, electrical miswiring? And I think there's no interest in doing it that at all. So yeah, I would. I would like to, if we could, Mr. Chairman, take a measure of, can we just confine it to the concept of natural disasters and, you know, how that could shape the land use of our constituent, governments.
So on a personal note, as an electrical contractor, I always take offense to electrical fires.
I've just never, Mr. Chairman, I've never heard of a town being wiped out from a leaky faucet.
Director Graves.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I concur with my colleague from Goulden here. I think that stating human-created hazards is a nice balance because there are times when human hands play a role in serious disasters that impact our communities. And so looking around the table, I don't know that it's unreasonable to include this along with natural disasters. Thank you.
Director Henry.
Another good example of a human error could be a dam that was built. And those engineers that are sitting around the table, yes, there are times when they don't necessarily do their job. And dams do, if they break, wipe out cities.
As an engineer, no, I'm teasing. Director Stolzman.
Thank you. I think we should leave human-created hazards in to encourage, even though it's not measured perfectly yet and we'll improve it, I think we should encourage people to reduce human-created hazards like we've seen communities do with brownfields and other things that have been hazardous, and they remove those hazards, so that would lower the risk in that area, and then you could have jobs and houses there. So I think it's a good measure to leave in.
I would ask if there's anyone else that wants to speak to removing the human-caused or human-created, excuse me. See nobody jumping up and down. I would assume that the temperature is to move it forward as is. Director Millay.
I actually think Jerry raised a good point about defining high risk, and I just was wondering how staff was going to respond to that.
And you know, I actually, I'm glad you said that, because I did want to point out that there have been, along with moving this forward, there's been some really good ideas about urban drainage and flood control and ISO ratings and things like that. So I guess I'm thinking that using some of that data and then coming up with a more defined way of measurement, does that make sense? Okay. Yeah, no, thank you very much for bringing that up. All right, moving on then. We are at agenda item 6. And I do have a little bit of preamble before I turn this over to Mr. Calvert again. First of all, I want to point out that under agenda item 6, attachment 1 is the DRCOG strategic planning model that we've seen many times already. But I just want to point out that that is kind of the basis of some of the things we're doing here. I also wanted to point out that we have, what we're going to be looking at is regional initiatives and local initiatives. So if you would all turn to the first page past attachment 2, what I want to point out is that everything that is between regional objective and measures has already been forwarded to the board and the board has approved. Everything between measures related and initiatives has already been through either MVIC or this work session and has been forwarded to the board with a recommendation. So the first the first two blocks of areas, not saying we couldn't revisit something, but there's probably not a lot of need to because they've already been moved forward. So we're just dealing with the bottom third or whatever of the page it is, which is initiatives. Now, in order to be very clear, it was suggested, and I think it was a very good suggestion by Director Millay earlier, that we add some verbiage to the initiatives to make it very clear that what this is it's voluntary options. So on each one of these where there's the word initiatives, what we're going to add or what we're proposing that we would add is the verbiage menu of voluntary options available to organizations. So if you look on the left side, there's regional, and on the right side, that's local. And the idea is that we're trying to clarify very succinctly that these are options, they're not requirements, and it's just a menu of options that are available. So does that make sense to everybody? That, and if somebody has a recommendation of different verbiage, but the recommended verbiage was menu of voluntary options available to organizations. So with that, we can talk about the regional and local collaboration, understanding that these are, again, a menu of voluntary options. I don't know, I would prefer not to get into a lot of wordsmithing, but if somebody wants to do that, we can do that. But the idea with this was that it was not going to be a long, drawn-out discussion, not discouraging anybody from saying anything they want. Director Cernanek.
This is neither wordsmithing nor anything else, but in addition to it's an additional item. In addition to saying these are voluntary options, as things will pop up and this document lives for quite a while, will there be a place or could there be a place where a more extensive list as other ideas pop up can be available through DRCOG?
Mr. Colbert. Yeah.
Yes, I mean, we have sort of kicked around this idea that one of the things that we would do after the plan is adopted is the term that we've been using is sort of toolkit for local and regional action that would go even beyond this. Like, this is not exhaustive. I mean, that's the one thing that I might add to what the chair said, is that this is simply, it's not an exhaustive list. It's a starting point, and we will all be doing innovative things that ultimately are contributing to the shared outcomes established in the plan, and it's our job in some ways to kind of understand what those are and to celebrate them and that sort of thing.
Well, and you know, you have forums at times, yes, where ideas pop up, and to be in a position to capture that, and you might want to mention it in the document that there's more available.
Yes.
So one of the things that's in the narrative is the question, what else could we, DRCOG staff, do to drive the achievement of outcomes and regional objectives, noted in attachment 2. Are there other things that people, when they reviewed the backup here, would like to have added, or are we good moving this forward and taking a deeper dive at the board level? I'm seeing heads nod up and down, so we will move it forward as is to the board level. Thank you very much.
Can I add just one note? Just,
yes,
I think,
please.
I think it might be good for the group to hear. You'll notice that very, very, very long list, and so we did our best to try to kind of categorize, and so that's where you see like collaboration, policies and regulations and those sorts of things. And just given how much this has come up several times in this room over the course of the past few years where we've been looking at this, you know, there are no initiatives, even though they're voluntary, that are described as policies or regulations on the regional side. This group has talked frequently that this is a vision plan, it's an aspirational plan. So, you know, we do not anticipate sort of that this operates like a policy document. The board has policy conversations later on any number of things, and hopefully, given all the work that you've spent on this, this document informs those conversations, but it is not the place that, that regional policy really sits and lives. So you will see that that's kind of a unique thing that's not really covered in terms of the sort of categorization on the regional side of things. I just thought you might want to hear that clarification. Sure. And then the other thing that was sort of, so I don't know if you want to celebrate yet, but in many ways you are done with the last step in the strategic planning model. That is a big thing. So I would first of all give yourself a round of applause. We'll talk about the preamble, and hopefully that'll be something that, that we did a pretty good job of taking comments in. But obviously you've done a lot of work over the past couple of years on this. And so we wanted to use this time to mention quickly, there was a concerned citizen by the name of Mr. Smith Young, who I don't know, and if he's here, sorry, I'm talking about you without really having met you, that sent around some comments on a few measures. And my sense is that they went to some board members, but not all board members. And, you know, we take sort of public comment that comes on these documents really seriously. And so we are going to distribute a sort of, let's call it a staff reaction or feedback to the comments that came in, including Mr. Young's original comments to the entire board, since we don't know who received the comments and who didn't. So that everybody has kind of a level playing field about, again, what the original comments were and then kind of what our reaction was. To give you kind of a high level of what you're going to see, most of his comments were really oriented on two measures that you talked about last month, sort of the share of households that are cost burdened in the region, as well as housing plus transportation cost, or the H plus T index. And you'll see in his comments that a lot of his concerns about the H plus T index were also concerns that staff kind of brought to you over the past year, which really kind of boils down to the fact that it's a third party vendor that we don't necessarily have a lot of control over the model and all those sorts of things that you've heard many times in this room. But you took that information and still made a decision to ultimately do a head nod or recommendation to the board to include that measure and the draft that will be released for public review and comment. So again, you're going to see something either end of this week, very early next week, that again, so that everybody sees the original set of comments and kind of our first stroke, kind of what we saw in those comments that are things that we think are legitimate and that you've discussed, and maybe some things that we'd like to see kind of show you a different side of that issue.
Director Graves.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Very briefly, as we mark this occasion for this milestone, I think it's important for us to recognize staff, the amount of time that they have taken to try to translate all the feedback from this board, as we've had some really passionate discussion and have wordsmithed many, 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 many items. I really appreciate all the work that's gone in by staff. Thank you.
Absolutely. Thank you.
Absolutely. And Director Graves, you might use the word plethora rather than many, many, many.
I'm not sure that the chair recognized Director Cernanek.
Okay, yeah, you didn't need
Executive Director.
Yeah, I just wanted to follow up on Brad's comments about the input that some of you have received from Mr. Young. Any input that you get that you're not necessarily sure what it means or how to respond, please feel free to forward that to Brad or myself. We will get back to you first, and if you'd like, we'll get back to the member of the public who submitted the comment, or we'll give you talking points so that you can talk with them as well. So that's really what Brad will have in his email to you later this week or first part of next week, kind of the response to these things. You can do it yourself, or you can strongly encourage Mr. Young to give Brad a call, and we'll go through all of his issues point by point.
Thank you. That was in my list of things to mention, and I forgot, so I appreciate you mentioning it.
Questions or comments on that item? All right, thank you. Oh, I'm sorry, Director Daigle. Is your mic on?
Oh, there. Do each of these stand alone, like the overarching theme and efficient and predictable development pattern? So someone would be able to look up that one and it stand alone, or does it all come in a big packet?
It will all be, you know, one of the things that you saw in the attachment for the last item, which, as the chair ran you through, started with overarching themes that ran all the way through initiatives.
Right.
That's the guts of this plan, and this group and the board will have looked at every single word that appears there, and then it will be reassembled into a larger document that has more formatting, more language, includes an introduction that we're about to talk about. So yes, it's thought of as a comprehensive, so there are really kind of five overarching themes.
Mm-hmm.
But we, in sort of designing kind of how the plan is laid out and how you think about it, we want it to stand alone, stand as one thing, but if you want to pull out one specific section and kind of understand, you can make sense of it that way too. That is our hope, because we, as much as I would love to say that everyone in this region is going to read this plan from the first word to the last, I'm not convinced that's really going to happen. But I would love for someone who, if they have a specific issue that they're really interested in, they can navigate to that, and that will stand on its own, and they will have a sense as to what the vision for the region the board has established through the plan.
That's kind of how I read it, was that it was an overall thing, but if I needed to go to a specific, I could. So really my I do have a suggestion, since okay. I'm new on the board and I don't know all of the abbreviations. Have definitely a table where I could look those up, or make sure that on each of the documents, like I noticed, like on outcome 3, they use VMT. Well, if I'm, you know, a regular person looking this up or whatever, I may not know that that has to do with vehicle miles and yep. travel. So that would be my only suggestion. Just make sure that anybody, if they wanted to, I don't know why they would want to possibly. I mean, but they could.
Sure.
But and not everybody's going to. I mean, I still don't know all the abbreviations. I have to look them up. I have to get out my book and go, what the heck is that abbreviation?
So, I mean, so we totally agree. Really, what this group and the board has been seeing is what I would call the shorthand version of the plan. When it goes out for public review, it'll be the longhand version. It will include a glossary that points
how
people understand. To give you an idea, one of the things that we've talked about is you saw this huge long list of initiatives that, for the purposes of what we're talking about today, they're assigned to one specific outcome, but there are initiatives in there that actually could contribute to success on multiple outcomes. So we want people to understand that there are multiple layers, and this is ultimately something that can, you can do one thing that contributes to multiple end goals.
And you could use this one to go with that
correct.
One, and
yep.
yeah,
yep.
I got it. I really did.
Director Sheriff Graves, did you have your hands up? No, okay. Oh, I'm sorry. Shorthand that I don't understand. No. Okay, on to agenda item 7. And a couple of things on this real quick. First of all, to Director Daigle's point a minute ago, we understand that, you know, boards, this board kind of shifts every probably 30% or more every year due to elections and all that. So I wanted to kind of talk a little bit about why the preamble's in there for people that might not have been here for some of these conversations. There was some concern expressed by the working group on having some sort of document a preamble ahead of the overall Metro Vision that kind of explained or gave a high-level executive summary of what you're going to look at when you get into the document itself. So during the May discussion, it talks there about some of the things that were suggested, and I want to point out that under attachment 1 is the recommended verbiage that we're going to discuss here in a minute. And if you want to know how we got there from where we were before, attachment 2 is the red line version that shows where we were and how we got where we are today. So we will be looking at attachment 1. If somebody wants to look at how we got there, we can certainly do that as well, but we're going to start there. And Mr. Calvert, anything to add?
I think you nailed it.
So I'll open the floor for questions, discussion. Director Millay.
Well, I have some edits because I had a lot of comments about this. And I think we spoke, I think, a lot of times about it being an aspirational vision. So I would like to suggest that when we discuss it at the very beginning in that first sentence, that counties and municipalities of the Denver region have worked together to advance a shared aspirational vision of the future of the metro area and to make life better for our communities and residents. So that would be one of my suggestions.
And I'm sorry, if I could just clarify, I want to make sure. So the only thing you changed was adding aspirational between shared and vision.
Yes.
Okay, thank you.
Aspirational vision, yes. Thank you. Sorry.
Thank you.
And then in the third paragraph, the region has a, I would like to add after, the region has a strong shared sense of its future, and the DRCOG Board of Directors recognizes this visionary, that the success of this visionary plan requires the collective efforts of, the success of this visionary plan requires the collective efforts of local, state, federal, and then just end it after not-for-profit organizations, put a period there. Because I don't think the missions are necessarily going to be aligned with DRCOG. There's a lot of nonprofits that have very different visions but can also be contributing to these goals. So those are, and then the other thing that kind of came up today based on some of the other directors' comments is that I do think we should spell out the fact that, And I think it addresses some of the concerns expressed by Mr. Smith-Young with the data being incomplete or not transparent because it was proprietary, or that we will be looking to refine our performance measures as we learn more. And I do think that is worth spelling out in this part of the document. So I don't have specific edits for that, but
so before we get a bunch of ideas on the table, I'd like to kind of take them in sequence. And I know that does have the danger of somebody else coming up with a different idea later that changes it, but rather than having 18 things on the table or 8 things on the table, I'd like to take them individually. So the first suggestion by Director Millay was the addition of the word aspirational between shared and vision. People generally like to have that in there, or are there other comments or suggestions? I'm not seeing anybody saying that they want something different, so I'm going to assume that we're good. Wink your right eye, we can't vote. All right, so we're going to move that forward and add the word between shared and vision. The second item is in the third paragraph, recognizes the success of this visionary plan, etc. Do you have that up there?
Yes. Okay. I hope. Yeah.
So does everybody have the opportunity to take a look at that and see if that makes sense to them? Again, I'm not seeing anybody that is strongly. Okay. And Director Millay, I apologize. I was still writing on the last, when you did the last one.
So she ended it.
Your other one was more.
But it's a general comment that I do think it's worth acknowledging that we're going with the best information that we have right now, but we anticipate getting better data. I mean, all of the points that we say when we sit at this table, but that are never written down for the public or future boards to see, like, why are we changing that performance measure? Well, we had some questions about that performance measure when we accepted it to begin with. And when we know better, we do better. And so I do think some language needs to be in this preamble that addresses that very issue.
And I'll just add, just so that the group knows, the draft plan, even the version that went out in February of last year, talks a little bit about sort of the importance of measurement and measurement design, but it isn't necessarily up front in the you know, what we're calling the preamble, but we can certainly make a note to try to bring some of that forward so it's seen early and often.
Director Teal.
Well, and so the refining the performance measure perhaps articulate, Brad, that, you know, yes, we do add additional measures as that data becomes available, but we'll also be willing to remove measures that prove to not be helpful.
So maybe it's not the word add, it's the word modify or revise?
Refine.
And then just say, you know, instead of just move, remove.
Director Pfeiffer.
I just want to make sure we're not creating, like, over-communicating.
What?
Over-communicate, exactly. So where it says Metro Vision is dynamic and flexible, does that not address this in a way?
That's what I was going to ask.
Right. On the second page.
The second page, fourth paragraph.
Yeah, it's in bold, or caps. Metro Vision is dynamic and flexible. Yeah. It says Metro Vision reflects contemporary perspectives on the future of the region and is updated as conditions and priority change. The DRCOG board makes minor revisions to the plan annually and major updates as needed. It kind of already says it. I don't want us to react because of one letter or person or anything like that. I just want to make sure we're already clearly already saying that we're going to be flexible and make changes as needed. I don't know if we need to say it a different way again somewhere else. So again, let's not make it a long preamble. Because I skip those when they're that long.
Could you just add at the end updates as needed and as we grow and learn together? And then that would answer.
Sorry, together threw me there for a minute.
Okay.
It could, yeah. But I just, yeah, something up there.
Something along those lines.
Yeah, I don't know what kind of. That might open up other questions. I just wanted to.
I'll come back to you, Director Gagle. Daigle, excuse me. Director Graves, you had your hand up.
Very quickly, I just wanted to agree with Director Pfeiffer. I think there's so much flexibility built into this document. I know that around the table, each of our communities wants every assurance that we have the flexibility to govern based on the needs of our constituents and the vision for our communities. But in terms of this shared regional vision, I think staff has done an excellent job at giving us the flexibility in this preamble to adopt and move on.
This is Kyle from North Glen. I agree with Bob about it says it's dynamic and flexible. I'm not sure if we need to kind of beat it with a dead horse and you know, make it even more wordier than it already is. So I like it the way it says, the way it is.
Director Daigle. Nope.
I actually like it either way, but in order to, you know, add to it, I don't think you need to add a whole nother paragraph, just maybe, and as we grow and learn, even. You don't have to put the together there. Yeah, because it really does say that we're dynamic and flexible, but it, you know, you could, either way. I'm not going to get my feelings hurt if you don't do it.
Director Applebaum. Okay.
As long as the English is correct.
Yeah, I won't get my feelings hurt either. I think these are different concepts, actually. That's what's got me puzzled. Saying that the plan is dynamic and flexible is not the same as saying that the metrics, which are actually fairly specific things, are going to be reviewed and revised and updated as necessary by the DRCOG staff as more and better information becomes available. They're not contrary to one another, but they're different from one another. They're very different from one another, at least the way I interpret it. I do think it's useful somewhere to say something about those metrics. Now, whether it belongs in the preamble, and I don't have the whole plan in front of me, or in some other place where you're kind of discussing how the metrics get used, that would be fine too if you don't want to extend the preamble. And I don't know if there's a place in here in the whole bigger document that gives some explanation of metrics, how they're used, how they're collected, how they'll be updated over time, how they'll be evaluated, and so on. If there is, put it there. That would be fine. But anyway, I think they're different concepts.
Director Millay.
I think so well stated. You should speak for me all the time. But the I'm just one. Yeah, exactly. Yeah, that could be an interesting meeting. We may arrange that sometime. I'm wondering where in that final paragraph where we talk about, it says measures described herein help to verify whether the collective actions of planning partners, blah, 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 et cetera, there. I actually do think that's an appropriate place to at least make the acknowledgement that the metrics will be refined as more and, as information is available. And it does not have to be exhaustive. I think it can be a sentence. And we are in that area specifically talking about, I would say the degree to which the outcomes, objectives, performance measures, and initiatives identify in here apply to individual communities will vary. I actually think we spell out everything else. Why aren't we talking about the performance measures and the metrics by which we're using to judge this whole plan? So, and I think that is an important part of the preamble. So,
Director Pfeiffer.
So, I do have some reservations with that because in a plan, if you open it up when you're trying to do objectives and you open it up and saying, well, it can change all the time, then how do you know you ever achieve an objective or a measurement? Because you're changing it to, you're chasing the bubble in my eyes.
That's secret by engineers.
Oh, secret by engineers. You should know that one. But we I don't want, I mean, I feel that if you have a goals, you have measurements, I don't want to put any, I would prefer that we don't put any words in there that would open it up to people thinking it changes every year. And I think that we're walking close to that line of saying, well, we're just going to change it to say, hey, we're 100% successful, when really we should be holding lofty goals over time. I don't mind mentioning something about we'll refine measurements on occasion due to new information or facts. And maybe it's under the practices paragraph, like you were saying. But let's be a little careful and reserved on why we would continuously change performance measurements.
Director Teal.
I mean, I completely agree that, yeah, we don't want it to look good, like it's loosey-goosey and we're chasing the bubble all the time. At the same token, I think it's appropriate to call out, we do mention measures described herein help to verify. Well, I think it is appropriate to get back to what Director Millay is talking about of calling out that we will change performance measurements over time as we learn more information. On the other hand, I'm 100% with Director Pfeiffer that, yeah, let's not have it a standalone paragraph. Let's wrap it into either the applying the Metro Vision principles in practice or the prior paragraph where we had, mentioned a little bit there with Director Daigle. So, I mean, I think either one. I think there's value, though, in calling that out. We had a member of the public question it. So I think there's value in calling that out and editorializing it.
Director Millay.
And I don't think I was suggesting we're changing the target, which is the goal. What I said is what we're changing is the measure and the metrics. And I think there's very different, and that is very different. How we measure something or what we measure may change. I'm not saying we change a target because we're not achieving it.
Well, you don't change the target, but if you change the measurement, you can meet your goal.
The way you measure it. Yeah. Well, okay, but that is not what I'm suggesting, well, nor do I want that in the document.
No, but
so I want to make it clear. And I actually think there's a sentence that could go in there that would not be exhaustive that would make it work.
So let me interject real quick. It seems pretty clear that it's important that we have something in here that captures that that the measures could change. And I think staff has heard the conversation. We'll let them kind of move forward with that. And I've got several people in the queue. I do want to ask real quick if there's anybody on the phone that has a question that would like to chime in. Hearing nobody, I have Director Karis Graves, Teal, and Partridge. And Director Karis Graves, I apologize for mispronouncing your name earlier.
So
as I was listening to the discussion, what I was thinking is that we absolutely want to make clear that we're not interested in becoming less rigorous, but our measures can become more sophisticated. And so we're allowing for that to occur. And by simply calling it out, we're advising future directors who are not here at this table hearing this discussion to that point. I don't think it needs to be long or drug out I think it needs to point to that part, that we're not changing the standards, we're not lowering our standards, but we might need to allow for greater sophistication in how we look at those standards.
Okay. So I have Director Teal and then Director Partridge. Director Teal.
Yeah, actually, I think, Mr. Chairman, you captured my comment. I think this would be appropriate to kick back to staff. I think, you know, Brad's heard the conversation. I think I trust him to integrate it appropriately.
Director Partridge.
A question for staff, but first comment. When we look at this, as we say, this is a living document. Even though we have not defined living, whether that means it's a living document only every 5 years or is it at any time, I think we really look at that if we really are being true, and this is a living document that is to adapt and adjust. And if we look at our comprehensive, I don't know how everybody else's comprehensive master plan is, but whenever you make an amendment to our comprehensive master plan, there's a procedure to go through. It's a very rigorous procedure, and there's only three ways to occur. So the question is to staff, do we have that, a procedure for a change, and what is that procedure?
Mr. Calvert.
The answer is yes, and the same rigor is applied to an amendment as it is to the adoption of the plan itself, which is a majority of members of the board have to approve not only this plan, but any amendment to the plan in the future. And we do public hearings. There is lots of notice about potential amendments to the plan.
Right. So since we have a procedure in place, it's a living document. That's what I say. So I support the adaptation.
Okay. Other comments, questions, additions? Anybody on the phone want to comment? So with the suggestions that staff will work on the verbiage and these very specific things that we have modified, can I get kind of a acknowledgement that this is good to move forward to the board?
Mr. Chair, can I get one clarification? Yes, we had a suggestion here of and as we grow and learn, and I don't know if that was something that we...
I mean, as needed, it also applies, I guess, the same thing. As we grow and learn is a softer.
Okay.
So it should be one or the other. Would you agree?
I agree.
Okay. You can leave it.
You want us to figure it out?
Yes.
Yes. Okay.
All right. Some things you just can't unsee. So we're on to agenda item 8, and I will happily say that we are well ahead of schedule, which is unusual for this one. So we have a discussion of the HOV policy, and we have Mr. Jacob Rieger here to present.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chair and directors. So for a change of pace and topics, we're going to talk about an important transportation topic. We talked about acronyms today, and I am going to use the acronym HOV, but I am going to define it, and I'm going to talk to you about what it is. But what we're talking about here is high occupancy vehicles. And there are several sort of layers of this onion of sort of wrapped together of this issue of high occupancy vehicles or HOV policy. So there's several components that I want to talk through today, but sort of the quick background is that our former Metrovision Issues Committee was interested in this topic, had some exploration on this topic,
Staff has thought a lot about this, and we've had a lot of conversation with our Transportation Advisory Committee that you'll see in this presentation about how to kind of tackle this topic. And so we wanted to kind of bring you sort of a status of where we're at on this. But, you know, the specific things that we'll cover today, very brief, I promise, only one slide, but we want to review toll review history with you, and I'll explain what that is. CDOT last fall adopted their new high occupancy vehicle, or HOV, policy. I'll walk you through that. We have ourselves at DRCOG associated with our regional transportation plan. We have what we call additional information requirements for projects proposed to be in the plan that have a tolling component, and I'll talk to you about those. And then, as I mentioned, our Transportation Advisory Committee, TAC, had a lot of discussion and some recommendations around this topic, and I'll walk you through that. So first and foremost, what are HOV lanes? The graphic on this screen is from US 36 Community Solutions. This is a graphic that shows the sort of schematic for North I-25 and primarily US 36 of those high occupancy vehicle lanes. You know, bottom line, an HOV lane, I think many of us know, but just to kind of be on the same page, because there's a lot of terms thrown around, and I'll even have to do that today. You know, managed lanes, HOV lanes, toll express lanes, HOV express lanes. I mean, there's so many terms around this, but you know, an HOV lane, particularly here on US 36 and I-25, is a separately marked lane that's in the inside of the median. If I can get the mouse to. So here and here, that symbolized that only allows for free carpools, cars that have at least two, and as of next year, three occupants in the vehicle. So if you have that arrangement, if you're carpooling, you can use these lanes for free. However, if you're a solo driver and you want to save time and you're willing to spend some money, you can pay a toll and have access to these lanes as well. These are next to the free lanes on US 36 and North I-25, so you don't have to use these lanes, but certainly you can, obviously, again, if you're a carpool, and you can if you are a solo driver who's willing to pay the toll to use those lanes. And I will walk you through. We have many variations of this within the metro area, and I have a diagram in the presentation where I'll walk you through that in a minute. So I promised you one slide and one slide only on toll review history, but it's important, so I'll try and make it lively. Back in 2002, House Bill 1310 created what was then known as the Colorado Tolling Enterprise. In 2005, House Bill 1148 set this mandate of MPO review of Colorado Tolling Enterprise projects. So basically what it said is that if the former Colorado Tolling Enterprise was going to build a project with a tolling component, they couldn't take action prior to construction until that project had been reviewed by the MPO. So if it was within this region, obviously DRCOG is our Metropolitan Planning Organization. So again, another acronym, MPO, Metropolitan Planning Organization, regional transportation planning function that we have at DRCOG. So if Colorado Tolling Enterprise was going to build a project in this region, we had to review it and kind of sign off on it. That's what this legislation did. That was in 2005. In response to that, in 2006, DRCOG adopted procedures for responding to House Bill 1148 so that we could meet the intent of the legislation. Then in 2006, House Bill 1003 applied the language of House Bill 1148, and there will be a quiz on this at the end of the meeting. It applied that 1148 language to private toll companies. So what we're saying here is that we had the Colorado Tolling Enterprise version, and then we had private toll company version. But the legislation was similar, that again, prior to construction, you know, within this region, DRCOG as the MPO had to review and sign off on those projects. In 2009, DRCOG adopted procedures for RTP toll amendments, one for Colorado Tolling Enterprise, one for private toll companies. Again, you know, the letter of the legislation had these two different versions. We adopted two sets of procedures. That did a couple things. It replaced the 2006 1148 procedures, and those procedures, you know, have lived on till today, and that's what we'll be talking about. They're attachments 2 and 3 in your packet. Again, one for what was back then CTE, and one for private toll companies. And then finally, in 2009, the FASTER bill that I think we're all acquainted with, faster transit, faster safety. The faster bill passed, it abolished Colorado Tolling Enterprise, and it established what we know today as HPTE, so yet another acronym, the High Performance Tolling, High Performance Transportation Enterprise, which is responsible for the toll roads in this region. Some of the toll roads, we'll get to that. So if I haven't put you to sleep and confused you yet, I just wanted to give you that background because it's relevant as we talk through some of the components of this issue. I mentioned that CDOT adopted an HOV policy last fall, and I kind of want to walk you through that policy because it was the basis of a lot of TAC's conversation around this issue. Basically, CDOT's policy that was adopted by the Transportation Commission starts with the assumption that HOV3 is free. So in other words, that a project, you know, comes in, has HOV facilities, HOV3 is free. However, there are conditions under which the strategy may not be feasible on a project of having HOV3 component to it. And so the CDOT policy does recognize a few exceptions. If HOV3 might result in any of the following issues around safety concerns in the corridor, corridor performance measures may not be met, or if it renders the transportation improvements financially infeasible. So those limited exceptions for not having HOV3. Each managed corridor and lane can be assessed based on its unique circumstances and maybe reassessed as conditions change over time. So again, the CDOT policy starts with the assumption of HOV3, but does recognize some limited exceptions and recognizes that projects can be assessed on a project-by-project basis. I mentioned Dr. Cog's regional transportation plan informational requirements. So again, think back to that history of the two House bills, 1148 for HPTE and faster for HPTE, and then private toll companies, that we have requirements for projects that come into our regional transportation plan, that we have to review those projects with a tolling component. Whether it's a new project that comes, you know, brand new project that walks in the door that wants to be in our regional transportation plan, or a project that's already in the plan that has a major sort of change to that project. So, for example, as you see on the screen, if there's a scope change to the project is one example. You know, maybe we have in the plan a project widened 4 to 6 lanes. You know, now they want to widen 4 to 8 lanes. That's a major scope change. They would be subject to these informational requirements. If it's an operational change, so I mentioned HOV3 beginning next year, back in 2012, this was actually an amendment because it was a policy amendment to the Regional Transportation Plan that as of January 1st, 2017, through HPTE, the requirements, say, for I-25 US 36 will change from HOV2+ to HOV3+. So that itself was an amendment to our Regional Transportation Plan. It does not include sort of minor changes to projects. So if I have a project in the plan and all I'm doing is changing sort of the staging time frame, you know, that's minor. That doesn't apply. But if I've got a scope change, if I've got another major change, these additional information requirements would apply. Again, as you've heard me say a couple times, separate versions for CDOT HPTE projects and non-CDOT HPTE projects, again, based directly on the state statute that directed our review of these projects with a tolling component. I should emphasize that the state statutes, House Bill 1148 and House Bill 1003, referred to projects with a tolling component. So part of what we had to tackle as staff and as TAC was this issue of blending in HOV with the state statute that talked only about tolling. Both sets of requirements, they're very similar. They're not identical because, again, you're talking about a public agency of HPTE and private toll companies. So the language isn't identical, but it is very similar in attachments 2 and 3 that both address things like operations of the facility, the technology envisioned in the tolling component, the feasibility of the project, financing, environmental concerns, and regional planning and review process coordination. So here's a graphic, and this was in your packet in the presentation slides, but I wanted to kind of walk you through this just to give you a sense of the complexity and the variety of, you know, managed lanes or HOV lanes, you know, whatever term we want to use. We've got several flavors, you know, so if we're hungry and we think of ice cream, there are several flavors of ice cream in this region, and some of these facilities, you know, blend, you know, chocolate and peanut butter, chocolate and vanilla. So I actually want to walk you through and give you some examples of the diversity that we already have in the region of our managed lane facilities. I talked about I-25 and US 36. Again, these are These are facilities where HOV2 and starting next year HOV3 is free, but if you're a solo driver, you can also use that lane. You can pay a toll. That toll varies by time of day and by congestion, so we call that dynamic. Dynamic or variable pricing in that lane. So it's got a couple components there. I-70 Mountain Corridor has the peak period shoulder lane. This operates, you know, only a few times a year. Think of the Sunday afternoon, you know, coming back to Denver. So this is a toll lane. It also has variable or dynamic pricing, but it doesn't have an HOV component. The reason for that is because, you know, folks going up to the mountains, there's actually already a lot of carpooling. So the ability to have this extra capacity and to manage that capacity, having an HOV component actually wouldn't help very much. That's where the variable dynamic pricing comes in, you know, to make that lane free enough to provide a, or free enough, to make that lane, to have enough capacity in that lane to make it a benefit that people would want to use the lane, but to use pricing to manage the capacity within the lane versus the free lane. So that's a little bit different. South Santa Fe Drive, here's an example of just a classic HOV lane. When the light is flashing, it's HOV. Otherwise, it's not. There's no tolling component. There's no variable pricing. It's either in operation or it's not. So that's, again, a different flavor. A project in our plan over the next few years is toll lanes on C-470. These will be managed as well in terms of variable sort of time of day pricing, but they won't have an HOV component. There will be future HOV3 plus projects extending the managed lanes on I-25 to the north and I-70 Central or I-70 East, east of downtown in Denver. Those are future HOV projects. Then we have our toll roads. Currently we have E-470 in the Northwest Parkway. In our regional transportation plan, we also have the Jefferson Parkway. These are just straight up toll roads. These are not, you know, there's not an HOV component. There's not really a managed component. The price of the toll may change somewhat over time, but these are just toll roads. They are what they are. And then when we talk about managing a lane, we also have bus lanes and bus rapid transit. So today on I-25 and US 36, part of Fast Tracks was the Flatiron Flyer bus rapid transit that uses the HOV lane. We also have in our regional transportation plan future bus rapid transit projects on State Highway 119 between Boulder and Longmont and on Colfax. So those will have different flavors of how that capacity is managed in those lanes. So that's another flavor of managed lanes. And then finally, we have Broadway and Lincoln bus lanes. So again, I don't want to bore you to tears, but I want to give you a sense of the diversity of what we already have in this region in terms of managed lane facilities. So let's get to what TAC talked about. They had a very robust and thoughtful discussion spanning four meetings between January and May of this year, where they really kind of thought through and talked about this issue. They talked about updates to the RTP in additional information requirements. Again, those were from 2009. They hadn't been updated since then. So we still had references to Colorado Tolling Enterprise. We had other things in there that we wanted to update and clarify, kind of streamline the requirements. So we worked through TAC to do that work. And in your attachments, attachments 2 and 3 are the clean versions, but if you want to see sort of the sausage making, attachments 2A and 3A, which were links, actually show the redline version of all the changes made to the additional information requirements.
Director Atchison.
Yeah, Jacob, not so much a question, but just a clarification. Can you go back about two slides? All right, well, go too far. Come back to your graph. There you go. All right. Here's the thing that people need to keep in mind with this managed and toll facilities. We're talking about free, but free only applies if you have the transponder. If you don't have the transponder, and if it's not set to the appropriate side, you're paying a license plate fee, which is highest peak time rate. So as you talk to your community, make sure they understand. You don't just get to drive in the lane and drive on it. You still have to have the transponder. Now, based on an agreement that CDOT made during the last legislative session and the discussion with House Bill 123, those transponders are no longer going to be charged for. So even if you already have one, sometime over the next couple of years, you're going to get your $15 back. When and if CDOT and the tolling authority for C-470 can figure out how to change the software to show that that's refunded, because right now it's considered as a revenue stream for them to have those. And they've got something like 80,000 of them they haven't given out yet that's got to be paid for. But, and is January 1 is the implementation date of HOV3. HOV3, when it goes in, will go in anywhere HOV requirements exist. It's not an option. It's a mandate. However, with that mandate comes some concern. They have no way to identify that there's a third person in the car. So if you get a citation for not having the three, you're going to have to go to HPTE and the tolling authority to dispute whether or not you had a third person in the vehicle, because software today, even in the one Virginia model that they're alluding to, is not in the public. It has not been proven that it works. And serious concerns are being raised about privacy issues of someone using a software package that can see into your vehicle to try to figure out how many humans, not mannequins or dogs or puppies or cats, but humans are in the vehicle. So there's still a number of issues that we are dealing with along the I-25 corridor and 36th corridor, because I sit on both of those, in trying to help work with CDOT and RTD, and how do we resolve some of this, and we're a long ways from getting there. Thank you, sir.
Yeah, thank you. So coming back to TAC's conversation, so they talked about updates to our additional information requirements for the regional transportation plan. They also wrestled at some length with this sort of issue of, you know, should we have a regional sort of one-size-fits-all blanket, you know, whatever term you want to use, HOV policy, or do we want to have a narrower approach? And that can be sort of as wide or as narrow as anyone wants to make it. One of the things that we all kind of collectively wrestled with was, and you've heard me say this, is that, you know, from the legislations, from the statute, again, HPTE and private toll companies, nothing was envisioned sort of in between. You know, so what about the E-470 Public Highway Authority or the Jefferson Parkway Public Highway Authority? They're not HPTE, but they're not necessarily private toll companies. What about a municipality who wants to, on a non-state roadway, you know, try a sort of managed lane approach on a busy roadway to, you know, get some additional capacity, you know, something like that. I mean, I can come up with examples all day, but one of the things that we wrestled with and TEC wrestled with is, you know, what to do a little bit with the limitations that we had from statute while still wanting to address this HOV issue. So, you know, they talked at a lot of length about that, and we talked a lot about CDOT policy, and TAC had some questions for CDOT about how does the CDOT policy address exceptions that I mentioned, the three sort of limited exceptions, as well as the issue of transit service, which isn't specifically mentioned in the CDOT HOV policy. So through these four meetings and all of that thoughtful discussion from TAC, the outcome was a couple things. One is that the HOV topic is certainly very important and worth addressing, but TAC felt it was best addressed through the existing RTP additional information requirements for toll project reviews. We already have these requirements for these types of projects to get in the regional transportation plan. TAC felt that was the best way to sort of tackle this HOV issue. Specifically, they had three distinct recommendations. One was to directly incorporate the CDOT HOV policy in the CDOT HPTE version of the RTP additional information requirements, and that's attachment two. To incorporate sort of that same content, but in terms of an ask, not a mandate, but an ask about HOV3 provision in the private toll company version of the RTP requirements, and that's attachment three. And then in both sets of requirements to ask about transit service provision, you know, for both HPTE projects and private toll company. The logic here from TAC was, you know, a couple things. One is that, and I want to emphasize, you as the board can ask for, you know, whatever you want whenever you're reviewing a project that wants to get in the regional transportation plan. So this isn't meant to either prescribe or direct, you know, how you conduct your review, but it's maybe to set a baseline or a starting point of what TAC felt, you know, is where we should start from of the types of things we would ask about. And by asking about it, you know, we can at least ask for the information, not necessarily mandating, but at least ask and see what kind of responses we get. So in attachment two and three, which are the RTP information requirements, you'll see that sort of language in there about incorporating the CDOT HOV policy and about asking about, for private toll companies, HOV considerations, and for both of them, transit service. And so with that, that's all I have, and I'd be glad to answer any questions.
Questions or comments? Director Pfeiffer, please.
Was there any discussion about bringing some consistency on how we use it and what, like, existing? I mean, one thing off the top of my head that pops in is, if the users are confused, will we still get the desired outcomes? I mean, the outcomes are reduced traffic and so forth. And if there's user confusion on when they can use it, when they can't use it, if the lights are blinking yellow, is it 25 cents? Is it free here? Was
the blue light special?
The blue light special on a one block radius. I don't know, but was any of that discussed about how the users would be affected? Because if I was confused, I might just avoid it.
Right. I'd say we probably didn't get down to that micro level of detail, but the RTP additional information requirements certainly do ask about, you know, some of those components. And let me go back up in the presentation.
It's just like that one right there on the map. I mean, that clearly shows how confusing, because I use it, but maybe it's just my wife and I, so it's two, we're going to move it to three, but here it might be free, but there I got to pay. I don't have my transponder yet, but I need to have a transponder. You know, it's just, you know, buses drive on shoulders and they drive on the HOV on this lane. You know, boy, are we just adding a crazy freeway system, and just, can't we just...
And if you're a visitor?
Well, if I had a flying car, I'd just push the button.
Right.
But I just hope that we're really, really, really considering the user in this. We're all trying to figure out the capacity issue, but we're not thinking about the user and anywhere in here. And the user is the human driving the car, and right. Maybe the autonomous car, who knows, and down the road, who knows what that looks like. So...
Yeah, I hear you, absolutely. I think the way I'd characterize that is that a couple things. The bottom bullet on this slide, you know, the additional information requirements for our regional transportation plan do get down in some of those details about how this facility will work, you know, how it will relate to the other sort of facilities in the region, you know, what the technology is, you know, those sorts of micro-level details that I think you're getting at. But we all recognize it was probably a little bit of a balance between consistency and sort of user-friendliness, while understanding that, you know, we do already have this variety, and that, you know, one-size approach may not fit all, at least from TAC's perspective.
Or narrow it down from the dozen or whatever flavors to six. I mean, there has to be some level of it. I'm afraid we're not going to get the desired outcomes because of confusion. And then on top of it, what are we adding in costs to our taxpayers to evaluate, you know, maybe incorrect tickets or, you know, all these other issues that are going right. to come out of this because of confusion? And do we just create more aggravation at the taxpayer expense? So I just, hopefully we're being very thoughtful through that.
So in the queue I have Stolzman, Cernanek, and Atchison. Director Stolzman.
Thank you very much. I appreciate the information. Did TAC talk at all about what impacts they thought this would likely have on single occupancy vehicle, and if they thought it would actually discourage people from carpooling in the future, and then what things we could do to incentivize people to carpool? It's incredibly hard to organize a legitimate carpool, and to put all of these things in place, it just seems like you're taking any incentive that was there away and making it very challenging to coordinate an ongoing carpool.
Yeah, no, it's definitely an important issue, and we kicked off the conversation by presenting some research that kind of talked about some of those, you know, policy issues and some of the things you're bringing up about who's using the facilities, what happens if you make, you know, change A has effect B, you know, those sorts of things. We did talk through that a little bit with TAC, yes.
Director Cernanek.
I have a simple question.
No way.
Who do you call to find out what you need?
I knew. Yeah. I was waiting. I was waiting.
You know, are we adding to the DRCOG ombudsman telephone response yeah. line so that folks can figure out what they need where?
Yeah, I hear you. I mean, the short answer is C.HPTE.
I was going to say. Yeah, that's one of the things I was going to mention is good questions, but I'm not sure how much direct control DRCOG has over this. It's CDOT. Director Atchison.
kind of going back to Bob's point about how much information we're giving out, there was just recently, about a week ago, a transportation forum put on by Smart Commutes Colorado. What the projection of the panels that were there, and this is some of the leading national experts on driverless cars, two things. One, they fully expect we will see driverless cars on the highways in Colorado within the next 5 years. People like Google, Ford, Lyft, Mercedes, Tesla are already putting in excess of $1 billion per company into planning for the manufacturing of these cars. But guess what they're manufacturing? Two-person, four-person cars. Four passengers or two passengers with no drivers. So that immediately brings us in the point of HOV3. You can't use those on the toll road because they won't have capacity for three people. So we're going to have to understand that these policies that are currently being implemented are going to be a problem within a few years that we have to go back. So the legislative bills that are in there and instituting HOV3, I will promise you it's got to come back up again. And then what's CDOT going to do to what they just implemented when they're going to change? And this is also part of the thing that CDOT is looking at with Project X that's being funded to the tune of $20 million by CDOT to look at these technology changes coming and how we're going to deal with them. This is a nice big fat bucket of worms sitting out there that's just going to continue to have to be dealt with, because as smart as we get, we're never smarter than the next new idea down the road that's going to change this. But we, sitting here as Dr. Cog, are not going to be in control of that. We're going to have to respond to it and try to deal with it as it comes out. But we're not going to ever be able to get ahead of it because the technology is moving too darn fast to the point legislation even can't keep up. And we're seeing this as there's a negotiation going on right now with RTD to put a contract together with Lyft to be the new first and last mile provider of getting people to the train stations and the bus stations. And when they do, some of the bus stuff that we see today with an example might be call and ride. They'll go away because Lyft will have those contracts if they can negotiate a rate with PUC. So these things that we're talking about, as I said, they're just a monumental snowball running down the track on changes. They're just coming faster than we can accommodate them.
Director Graves, do you want to follow that?
I'll try my best, Mr. Chairman. First, a mint chocolate chip for me all day on flavor. Coffee chip for Jackie Malay. Great. So I support the direction the TAC is going with this, the questions they've raised. Wondering if Dr. Cog or CDOT have talked about exempting public transit from managed lanes. We've been thinking a lot about how this potential costs of managed lanes, of toll lanes, might be passed on to consumers of public transit services. And so I'm wondering whether or not there's any talk about exemption or just where we are there.
Yeah, so two things. And you can see here in TAC's recommendation, you know, certainly the broader sort of policy issue is transit service being included. If you're building these managed lanes, these HOV lanes, you know, are they transit capable? Are they transit, you know, do they facilitate transit service? So that's something that, you know, TAC specifically recommended be asked about. But on the more sort of policy side, actually, I'm going to call on Jeff Sudmeyer from CDOT, because we've had a little bit of that conversation from CDOT's perspective, HPT, and really CDOT. I'd like him to address that.
Sure. Thanks, Jacob. Jeff Sudmeyer, CDOT Multimodal Planning Branch. So on the transit question did come up at TAC, and the CDOT policy that Jacob referred to does not have any special provision for transit. So in other words, a transit vehicle is as any other vehicle. If the facility allows HOV travel, a transit vehicle is presumably an HOV vehicle. If it does not provide for HOV use, its transit vehicles are able to use it as a tolled vehicle like any other. One of the reasons behind that is recent FAST Act guidance essentially has said that So goes for public transit, goes for any type of private transit. So any type of provision that would say we want to treat, say, an RTD bus this way or even our own Mustang bus this way would mean we'd have to have apply the same policy to the airport shuttle, to Greyhound, to a host of other providers that would then come in under that transit definition. So I think that's one other new one. If there's any other questions, I'm happy to answer. Matt.
So I'm not sure we knew we had a seat out rep. Now there's going to be a plethora.
Yeah, I know. Yeah. I was kind of hiding in the back.
So I had.
I tried to hold off as long as possible.
Director Pfeiffer and then Director Graves.
Okay, so I'm curious, and maybe we're getting into the weeds, but obviously we're interested in this topic. I'm just curious if there was any traffic impact, you know, studies where you can actually see when you make these changes how traffic changes over the next 5 years. We haven't seen them, but has our staff seen them?
Yeah, short answer is yes, and let me sort of give context for that answer. So these additional information requirements, most projects that come into the regional transportation plan don't frankly have to go through this level of sort of detail of providing this sort of depth and breadth of information. But through these, and again, let me get to that slide, you know, again, this sort of bottom bullet operations, technology, feasibility, you know, we actually ask for a fair amount of information. It doesn't necessarily require its own study, but it certainly requires provision of information and data. And some projects in the past have chosen to respond to our information requirements through traffic studies or traffic and revenue studies that they were doing anyway for their own projects. So some of those, yes, we have seen. So that's on the front end, you know, in a project coming into the plan, but we have seen that.
And is the result when you move it to HOV3 and all the managed lanes and so forth, that shows an improvement in traffic flow overall? Or because if you've seen these studies, I'm just curious, we're here. And I know it's CDOT's policy, but I'm going to get into where is Dr. Cog's role in this if you're asking us to address in our regional transportation planning process. And if the decision's already been made on some of these things, which I get it's at the state level, but if Dr. Cog's going to get behind it, I'd like to understand the true impacts.
Sure.
I'm not bought off on all of this just yet.
Sure. No, absolutely. And you raise a good point that I wanted to sort of clarify to hopefully provide a little bit of reassurance. The sort of concept here behind all of this is that, you know, is this an issue that we care about, meaning HOV? And if it is an issue that we care about, you know, do we want to investigate how projects are addressing them as they come into our regional transportation plan? By doing that, we're not necessarily bringing upon ourselves self-created problems about, you know, who do you call or what happens when the lanes get put in or what do you do about a transponder. Those, frankly, aren't things that Dr. Cog has to solve. So that's the good news. The point here is just from a regional transportation planning perspective, if we want to include this issue in the work that we already do in terms of evaluating projects for the RTP, this is the method that TAC recommended that we do it. We don't have to do it. We can do less, we can do more, but it's, again, not to bring these problems of all these solutions that we have to, you know, we have to find solutions ourselves. It's more an investigation, sort of gatekeeping as these projects want to come in and receive funding for a regional transportation plan. Does that make sense?
Yeah, it does a little bit. I just want to make sure that, you know, if I have some reservations, I'm sure there's others that might have some. And then
sure.
are we the organization all of a sudden holding the bag? And, you know, sorry, CDOT, if, you know, really they're the ones who are creating some confusion in the users or whatever the issues are that arise. I just want to make sure we're clear on what is expected of Dr. Cog in this discussion and what is CDOT's roles and responsibilities in this. So I don't want us to overcommit or put something into any type of plan that implies that we are the owner decision maker of how these are working or so forth. So
yeah.
Just I'm a little cautious about that.
Absolutely. And it's HPTE's, you know, by legislation, by mandate, it's their role to address and manage, you know, these types of facilities in our region and around the state. You know, that is not our role. We don't manage them. We don't operate them. We don't collect the tolls. We don't deal with transponder issues. That is not our role. By statute, that is HPTE's role, among other things.
Director Graves.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Closing comment. So just for CDOT and Dr. Cog, Denver is very interested in the nuance between how
public versus private transit options will be treated in managed lanes, and we do think that public transit should be treated differently and should not have to absorb that expense and have that passed on to consumers of that service. Thank you.
Director Partridge.
Since we have time for discussion, I just thought here. When we look at transportation, when we look at highways, roads, we look at, no doubt, moving people, but also goods. And maybe that's with Jake. I don't know if you have information on this or even CDOT. So when you look at the argument, say a bus would then qualify as HOV, what about an 18-wheeler doing delivery? Because you look at an 18-wheeler, certainly says providing large amount of goods being transported versus a panel truck. So has there been any discussion to say, how do they decide whether it's a panel truck doing delivery? Could, right now, could have two people who easily count that versus an 18-wheeler says I'm much more efficient. Has there been any discussion regarding that?
No.
It's coming.
Mr. X.
Thank you very much. I didn't know if there's anybody else wanted to comment, but I did have some information that may address the question that Director Stoltzman had related to how this affects carpooling, and to a lesser degree might answer, might help provide some fodder to the question that Director Pfeiffer had mentioned. There was a study that was done back in 2012 by Resource Systems Group on behalf of HPTE, looking at the change from 2+3 to 3+3. And the results revealed that most HOV users, two plus, will remain in the managed lane and pay the toll. That was approximately 70% of those who currently are using HOV service would remain in the managed lane and pay toll. Some would attract a third occupant, about 6%. Some would move to the adjacent free general purpose lane, about 22%. And then there's, to a lesser degree, about 1% would switch to transit, and there's about 1 to 2% that was going to switch back to single occupancy vehicles. So just some additional information. We have this study. If anybody is interested, we can share the link to it.
Director Stoltzman, you have 1 minute.
Quick follow-up question. Was that based on observation or just people's responses to a survey?
Good question. I don't know the answer, but I can find out.
So we are kind of up against the clock. We have 5 minutes until our next meeting starts. If I could ask everybody to take your name tag with you and put it out there so staff doesn't have to gather them up. If you need a parking ticket, please come see Connie. And those that are in the performance and engagement committee, we're in Monarch Pass in 5 minutes, and at 5:55 we're adjourned.